Well, welcome. The symphony season is here again. We hope that this coming weekend that you'll go down to Town Hall. This is usually the most challenging symphony that Claflin Hill puts on.
You mean the opening concert?
The opening concert.
Yeah, they're all pretty challenging, but this is usually the most classical, you might say.
So why don't we start with an introduction?
Paul Serpine, founding artistic and executive director at Claflin Hill. And to my right is Al Correa.
Year 17.
Yeah.
What an accomplishment.
17 years. Yeah, it's kind of hard to think about that, huh? I mean, we're using sort of a tagline this year borrowed from the Frank Sinatra song, you know. When I was 17, it was a very good year. So it's like Claflin Hill, season 17, it will be a very good year.
But Claflin Hill just keeps going. I mean, it's the kind of Energizer Bunny theme that as you look and start seeing how many artistic organizations have faltered or failed, Claflin Hill just seems to keep going.
Yeah, I mean, we're going and we're growing, too, you know? I mean, knock on wood, you know, because I never, like, stand back and just start saying, well, we're doing great now. But things are going well. Of course, the orchestra always sounds great. You know, we had a phenomenal season last year in terms of artistic accomplishment. You know, the concerts were just one after another, really blew our own minds. And the audience raved after every single concert. And it was also fiscally one of our best years ever. I mean, we had more new ticket buyers, more new audience members come through the doors last year than at any season in our history up to that point. I think our ticket sales revenues increased by like 33% last year. That's a pretty healthy chunk.
That's amazing.
Private donations increased. Corporate sponsorships kind of kept on about an even keel. You always lose one or the other and you get a couple new ones. The youth orchestra program, you know, for those people that don't know, we also have a youth orchestra component of Claflin Hill. And when I took over that youth orchestra, originally it was called the Metro West Youth Symphony. I became its director in 2005. At that point, there were probably about 40 kids in it. This year, we have almost 100 students in the youth orchestra program. We have three different ensembles, and we launched a new chamber music program last week with the kids, where they could also sign up to be in smaller chamber music groups, you know? So they're coming even earlier to rehearse, you know, in various little configurations, string quartet, woodwind trio, things like that. But the youth orchestra program is growing by leaps and bounds. I mean, last year it grew, I don't know what the percentage was, but let's call it almost 30%. And this year it's already topped last year.
Wow.
And moving beyond that. So, and sometimes you might wonder, you know, why, you know? I mean, like, we're going through our annual report and, with our accounting firm that does our annual overview and audit and everything, you know, and sometimes they ask us questions, you know, why? I mean, I got a question, it's like, private donations went up like X amount of thousands of dollars last year. Do you know why? And I just wrote back in an email, you know, more people donated. I mean, we had more chair donors last year. I mean, and we had made a specific push on bringing in more people into that part of Claflin Hill membership, of endowing a chair annually and becoming that level of member, you know, which is actually a pretty good deal. But, you know, so I know that actually happened because we made a concerted effort on the board level to go out and reach out to people and bring new people in. As far as audience growth, you know, maybe part of it is the use of social media. You know, we've been more proactively doing things with Facebook and through the website.
We get the notices from Bernadette all the time.
Well, yeah, that, you know, constant contact, all the weekly newsletters. You know, another, but you know, not to mention the TV station here. I mean, you know, they're a big part of that. I mean, we're becoming really well known just by all the various facets of what Milford TV is doing for Claflin Hill. I mean, if you turn on the TV and you're watching a bulletin board or something, I mean, they're playing Claflin Hill recordings underneath that, and they play the recordings of our concerts quite a bit, and interview shows like this, Tim Cowett, the radio station, you know, I'm on the radio station every Tuesday. I mean, you know, it's a giant kind of mixture of things.
Sure,
that you
there's
do.
There's no single vehicle that's going to
you've been
get
doing
you.
It for 15, 16, 17 years, and sooner or later, it's bound to, like, kick in. I mean, I actually, before I came here tonight, I stopped at the office to check some emails, and, you know, I had, like, 45 minutes. I could do something else that I needed to get done. I ended up answering a voice message, you know, called the lady back. She was in Pennsylvania, and she was calling to inquire about buying tickets for the Holiday Pops, and she said, I may have a large crowd. It may be as many as 20. Turns out her daughter is in school at Clark, studies with one of our oboe players, as a matter of fact, and they want to come up. The kid has to go to a symphony concert at some point to fulfill a requirement of her course. She's a music minor. And she was looking around on the web, you know, to find appropriate concerts, and she found us. And so she had some questions about it, and, you know, but that was like, so you're down in Pennsylvania. She said, yes, you know, we live near Philadelphia, and I said, well, they have a pretty good orchestra there. She said, yes, we do. But, you know, they were considering going to the Boston Pops in Worcester, and I said, well, and she said, but it was like $90 a piece for the tickets. I said, and you're not really seeing the real Boston Pops anyways, because that's a runout orchestra that goes out on these.
It's like the traveling orchestra?
Yeah, you know, a pickup orchestra they send out as the Boston Pops. I said, and, you know, between you and me, not to brag, I think we give a better show. So, you know, I think you'll be happy you came here. So, you know, all in all these various things are going along pretty good. You know, we've got a great season outlined. You know, the neat thing is, like, you know, when people want to renew their season tickets from last year, or people want to buy season tickets that didn't buy them before. I mean, I think you can go on the website and buy a season ticket package, but it's the ones that want to renew and keep their same seats, like you have your same seats every year. There's not a way for us yet to do that via the online ticketing where we could lock your seat and give you a code that, you know what I mean? That
yes,
would be
if you
cool.
Renew.
We mail you a little, your seats are waiting for you, no one can buy them. You can go on the website, you can enter this code, and then click on your seats, and they're released to you. You know, that would be
that
neat.
That was what they did, one of the Republican balls many, many years ago. They sent you tickets.
Mm-hmm.
And all you had to do is turn the ticket over, and for $1,000 a ticket, enter the code, and the tickets were released to you.
Right.
I looked at them. I said, "That's rather nice. You're just
really
presuming
nice for
that
$1,000, I guess.
You want to charge me $1,000 a ticket?"
Uh huh.
I was like, "Okay, my whole chair donation doesn't cost that."
Yeah. Well, you know, but the neat thing is, you know, and Wayne Stockwell, our sort of IT guy at Claflin Hill, who kind of puts up all these programs and systems, you know, for ticket buying and so on. I mean, he went out to California to the ticketing company. Vendini had a big symposium in the summer, you know, so they went out there to kind of find out what more we could do with this system, and actually asked a lot of questions of other orchestra people from across the country that were there, you know, about, well, how do you do this, how do you do that? And they came back and said, you know, it turns out we're doing everything pretty good.
That's good.
But to hear. But when I was asking Wayne, I said, well, what, you know, isn't there a way of doing this? He said, nah, not yet. But he said, you know, I want them to have to call and talk to you. Because I think that's an important thing. And that is kind of neat. You know, I mean, I've been talking to our audience like for 6 weeks now on the phone. You know, if you catch me in the morning, because that's when I'm there. But I've had the chance to chat, you know, at length. You know, somebody calls, you know, it's probably going to be a 20-minute call talking about how was your summer, what's going on. I love the season you guys have planned. Thank you so much for doing this.
Call the Boston Pops.
And ask for Keith Lockhart or something.
Can I talk to Keith?
Yeah.
He probably wouldn't be anxious to spend 20 minutes talking to me.
Yeah, I mean, it would be a good idea, though. I think that's kind of neat. So, I mean, that's a unique aspect of Claflin Hill. Maybe someday, you know, a future director probably won't have the time to do that, and there'll be some minions in the office or something chewing gum and, you know, playing solitaire or something in between phone calls. But, I mean, right now, people get to call, and I talk to them, and you know, it's like you're taking the pulse of your audience and having this interaction that, you know, on the night of the concert, when you walk out, it's like you really do know all these people sitting in the room there. So,
well, I mean, when you look down, you can look at, okay, Frank and Virginia usually sit there, and the Seavers. I mean, you almost feel like, okay, the Tessinis sit there. You can just look and you're expecting.
Well, I know. I mean, I'm doing that as I'm talking to the audience sometimes. It's like I may be looking around as I'm, you know, doing my introductory chat about the next piece or something, but in my brain, I'm like, you know, where's Al Correa tonight? How come his seat's empty? Where the hell is he? You know, or so-and-so's sitting
right
in so-and-so's seat. How did they get those? You know,
right.
I mean, what are they doing? And who's sitting in John Seaver's seat? Who is that person?
You know, there's, you know, stuff like, I got such a kick out of looking at the orchestra and seeing a Little Sorrapine, or seeing, you know, there are two or three kids, Milford kids. And you always think of them as kids. These are obviously accomplished musicians to be playing amongst the Claflin Hill Orchestra.
Mm-hmm.
But there is that feeling that, hey, that's one of our kids.
Well, I mean, you know, we've had several. I mean, Kevin Donegan, who grew up in Milford, went to Milford High School, was our first ever Claflin Hill intern when he was in high school. He came and played in the summer concerts with us and went off to music school. Came back, got a teaching job in front. Now he's in Weston, you know, at the Weston High School, directing music there. And, you know, he's works, mentors kids in our youth orchestra program. It's not like they're kids. I mean, yeah, they were kids,
I mean,
when they came into the program.
It's hard to look at these accomplished musicians, but no, it's Little Sorrapine. He's still only that big, and he's a kid. Then you realize, my God.
Well, actually, he's a lot bigger than that.
Well, that's what I'm saying,
like
my God.
Like 6'5 or something.
They've grown up.
Yes, they've grown up. And, I mean, we've got, I think, maybe four professional musicians in the orchestra that I can say were in the youth orchestra at one point or another. So,
so now, the youth orchestra is growing.
Mm-hmm.
If somebody was to say, I have a child in the high school or wherever the program, there's a music program.
Mm-hmm.
Why would I put them in the youth orchestra?
Because, I mean, you know, every town has a music program, and some towns have phenomenal music programs, and some towns, you know, maybe aren't throwing enough money in their budgets toward the music department or whatever. I mean, there are towns that don't even have a string program anymore. I mean, you know, Milford has still maintained, you know, the wide variety of offerings in there, you know, in the music department. I mean, they have orchestra, they have string teachers. I mean, they have a lot of those things. Franklin has an amazing music program and a really good orchestra program to boot. I mean, we have like 10 or 15 kids from Franklin in our youth orchestra. I mean, and they got a great program, but they like to come on Sunday to our youth orchestra because, you know, no matter how good your local public music program is, you know, by and large, there's a small percentage of kids in that that are actually pretty serious about it. They take their instrument home every night and they're practicing and they take private lessons and they yearn to play these things at a higher level, you know, instead of, you know, having to sit in rehearsal at school. Well, you know, you slug through something and, you know, half the kids haven't really practiced the music ever, and hopefully by December they'll have it learned well enough by rote. You know, in a youth orchestra program, kids get to spend hours on that day with kids of the same level of interest and dedication, you know, and that's meaningful.
It's kind of like going to college where the bottom of the curve all of a sudden dropped out.
Right. It's like when you get to college, suddenly life suddenly makes sense. It's, you know, when no matter what you went through in high school, you know, I went to high school. I mean, I didn't really have a social, I mean, okay, you know, maybe I was a geek or something.
Right.
I was a music geek. But you get to college and suddenly all the other geeks are here too.
Right.
And we all are talking the same language. And now life makes sense, you know? And I mean, it could be the same for kids or engineering
but it was
geeks
always the
or
same
whatever.
Because, okay, so you, now you're a music geek, I'm a chemistry geek, and you find out, okay, we're all the same anyway, just you're doing music.
Right.
I'm doing chemistry.
You know, and it's that, you know, so the kids in our youth orchestra program, I mean, it's really a blast. I mean, I'm there for like 6 hours on a Sunday.
Wow.
You know, sometimes longer because I get there before everybody else does. So how I start setting up things. Everything's got to be organized, you know. And, you know, I mean, when you get 100 kids walk in your door, you better know what you're doing. And they'll like, oh, wait a minute. Yeah, just sit there for a minute. I mean, you got to be in control for all 6 hours. Otherwise, you know, you may end up with some kind of circus going on, you know, as you can would understand, right? So. But the thing is, you know, I may wake up sometimes on a Sunday morning and wish that I had at least one day off in 7 days, you know, like, I got to get up, you know. And then I get there, and at the end of the day, I'm like, wow, that was fun. I mean, it's a blast. We have a great time. I mean, I'm kind of funny with them. I push them. They're playing the same level. I mean, they play the same pieces we play at Claflin Hill.
Is that right?
Oh, yeah. They're not doing, you know, little watered-down versions of something. I mean, last year we did the entire Star Wars suite with them in the spring and movements from Holst Planets, the real Holst Planets.
Really?
Right? Yeah. All in one concert. I was afraid they couldn't come up to it. I mean, not that they can't play it, but it was an exhausting program, especially for younger chops.
Wow.
You know what I mean? But they... You know, when I said, all right, you know, we'll start reading through John Williams' Star Wars suite, you know, the one that we did at the movie night at the Symphony 2 years ago. I mean, that goes on for a half an hour, and it's a lot of notes. It's a lot of, for wind players, just constant blowing. For the violin, constant scrubbing. I mean, you get done with that, and you feel like
you've gone through a workout.
Yeah, exactly. And I said, well, okay, maybe we can do a few, you know, this movement or that movement. And they were like, no, we want to do the whole thing. It's like, well, you're going to have to work because everybody knows this. It's got to sound good. You can't just...
Yeah, this is not an unknown piece.
You know, and no, they're a riot. I mean, they play great. I mean, you know, they always come and play on our March family matinee concert at Claflin Hill at Town Hall. And it's an opportunity to bring in the youth orchestra and to do what we call a side-by-side. So something that the youth orchestra is working on, they bring to that concert, and Claflin Hill Symphony plays that piece with them. So suddenly you have like a 150-piece symphony orchestra. Now, last year's side-by-side piece that we were working on in youth orchestra that I threw onto the program was Mars from the Planets by Holst. Now that is a savage.
I was
going to
say, that one grabs you and doesn't let you down.
Right.
Yeah.
I've never experienced a Mars like that one. I mean, a friend of mine, you know, we had a lot of regular Claflin Hills Symphony audience come to that concert, including a friend of mine, Chuck Shelley, from Northbridge, you know, who really likes music, and he kind of researches everything we're going to do before the concert, you know. I mean, he was astounded. He's still talking about it. I mean, I was hanging out with him a week ago, and he was telling somebody else about the youth orchestra kids with the orchestra, and that, you know, the roof practically blew off a town hall with the sound that we made on
Mars.
You made
the kids play Mars?
Yeah.
How outstanding. Of all of them.
And 1 year we did Jupiter.
Jupiter would be the
Mars and Saturn last time. And they did it, you know, they did a great job.
So I doubt it. Just wow, talk about a challenge.
So, you know, it's a neat thing, you know, and somehow also the word is widening there. I mean, that's also kind of a word of mouth thing, you know. If you get some private teacher and they send a student, hopefully the kid goes back and says they're having a great time in this youth orchestra, and that'll start feeding more. So,
I always remembered the concert at the school that hit me was what they brought together all the schools senior year, and you got to hear what your children sounded like when they were.
I think you may be talking about the vertical concert.
It's just amazing.
I mean, they have like the little kids.
The little kids.
The string kids from third grade, and then, and you know, Stacy Middle School, and they got the.
And you remember when my daughter got her first violin, and truly it sounded like you were pulling the tail off small farm animals.
Mm-hmm.
But somehow it sounded wonderful because it was my daughter playing.
Yeah.
And then you see the progression, and these aren't the all-stars, you know, the orchestra. These were the normal kids in
right.
the music program.
Yeah, and I mean, it's kind of when you look at something like that and you think, I mean, in a way, that's what music's all about. It should be for everybody. I mean, not everybody's going to practice, you know, an hour and a half every day after they do their homework. But yet, somehow, in you know, say, our public school system, when you go to a concert, they've managed to get these kids all doing this thing together, you know? So even the ones that are, you know, not practicing as hard as we would want them to practice, they've still experienced something that's broadened their mind, their experience, their outlook on learning. You know, it's an amazing thing when, you know, kids study music, just how much everything else they do gets improved because of that, you know, the way the brain has to work. I mean, you know, when a kid is studying music, and, you know, talk about little kids. I mean, you know, you're talking about kids sometimes that have trouble standing up straight or walking in a straight line, right?
Or
paying
whatever. Attention to something
paying
more
attention,
than 30
you know?
Seconds.
Right, exactly. And yet, they've got this odd, unwieldy instrument in their hands that they're trying to make some sound come out of, you know, and learning, figuring out how to manipulate that. You know, if it's a violin or a string instrument, you know, I mean, there's all sorts of ways you can make awful noises on it. You know, give a kid a clarinet and, you know, see, count the squeaks, you know, or the blats out of a trumpet, right? And they've got to physically start kind of training themselves to do that. At the same time, they're learning a brand new language that to somebody like yourself would look like Egyptian hieroglyphics.
Dead right? ants marching
yeah,
on a page.
Yeah, dead ants on a page. They have to translate that those symbols into something that's going in through their eyes to their brain and right out to their fingers in a flash of a millisecond. They have to listen to everybody around them because they have to do it together.
Now they've got to figure out how to work within a team.
Yeah. I mean, you've got all the violin players or all the clarinet players. They have to actually play as a section together, and then as a section, they got to play with the other sections. Or follow, and at the same time, following somebody up front waving a stick at them. Think about all of the multitasking that just went into that process of making two or three notes come out of an instrument, and put that same kind of brain, you know, mechanism to work on something else, and life becomes a lot easier.
I had
for
somebody
you.
Tell me that if your daughter, if your son ever plays in a real symphony, they're going to learn skills that whether they're a musician in the future or not, that they can take to the corporate world. And the way you describe it, okay, I've got my individual performance, which really does affect the department, the mm-hmm. section.
Right.
By the way, our departments have to work with other sections.
Mm-hmm.
And there's the CEO up front telling us where we're going.
Well, and in fact, an orchestra is a real model of a corporate structure. I mean, you know, from the top down. I mean, you know, you've got a conductor. Well, I don't know, you might call him the CEO or the chairman mm-hmm. of the board. You've got the concert master who sits right to his left in the first chair violinist.
Ongel
is our concert master, Ongel Valshinov. You know, he's my right arm, even though he's on my left side. You know, he tells all the string sections how he wants them to play together to do what he's seeing I want to do. And all the section leaders of each of the string sections, you know, the second violins, the viola section, the cellos, the bass, you know, they all take their lead from him, and then everybody behind them follow their leader. You've got the whole wind section, you know, so it's...
You got
it's
the poor very, guys in percussion that you always wonder if they're driving...
No, you leave them alone. They're just, you know, they're special teams, you know. They're like the punt return team, or, you know, they come out, you know,
I'm always amazed because you're sitting there and all of a sudden you hear ting, 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 you know. Oh my God, if they ever missed a note, you would know right away.
Yeah.
You know, the poor guy with the drums, those kettle drums, it's like, do you not like him making him carry those around?
They have wheels. You know, he could have played triangle if he wanted, you know, he could put it in his pocket.
You know, my other daughter took up the flute, I was very happy.
Yeah, I know.
You know, you start seeing the cello and these other choices, the flute made me in piccolo.
Yeah, small instruments are more fun to carry to school. I had to, at one point, I remember in junior high school, we lived inside of the busing radius where I went to junior high school, and so I had to walk every day, you know, with my clarinet and all my books. And sometimes had a tenor sax, which was very heavy. And I, you know, it was like you had to stop every block or two.
Put it down.
Put it down for a minute or change hand, you know. It's like, yeah, I don't know about the tenor sax. The clarinet's much lighter, so. But.
I feel bad for the tuba people. Well, actually, no, because they would have to get driven. You couldn't carry that too far.
Yeah, you don't want to, you can't send your kid off to school with a tuba in his arms. So, no, I mean. So, yeah, I mean, we probably didn't come here to talk about the youth orchestra,
no, but
it's a really good thing. And actually, you know, it's becoming a huge part of Claflin Hill, and it was always an important thing. You know, I actually I've been a teacher since I was 14 years old in a way. You know, I started teaching private lessons at the age of 14, you know. It was like, wow, you know, I kind of liked, you know, I would teach kids that were in fifth grade. You know, I'm in ninth grade and I'm a pretty good player, and I'm going to try out some of the things my teachers tell me to do on these kids. You know, people sometimes have asked me, you know, well, what if, you know, Claflin Hill became so successful that you didn't have to work at anything else? It's like, well, I would still always teach, because I think as a musician, if you're not teaching, you know, then there's something missing from your musicianship.
At your level, it's obviously a passion for the music. It's not a job.
You know? No, I guess not.
I mean, you have to make a living because you have those ungrateful offspring who want to be fed every day and clothed and have a home.
Yeah.
So, I mean, you got to deal with the basics, the bottom of Maslow's pyramid there.
Mm-hmm.
But above that, when you look at what these musicians do, you know, schlepping all over the place, bringing their instruments, not necessarily all of them getting the pay level they should be. It's mm-hmm. not commensurate with their efforts.
Right.
It's got to be a passion.
Yeah, and in the end, it's a good passion, and you know, I mean, I think when I started this, one of my goals was that I wanted people to understand that. I'll move this up a little higher, hopefully without.
It'll creating. Make him happier, so they'll be able to hear you.
Yes. That, you know, everybody says, well, you love what you do. And yes, that is true. And we're very fortunate that we get to do that because there's a lot of people that work, you know, an entire career just because they have to work. And it's not necessarily the job they dreamed of having or something that really is their passion in life. They can't wait to retire so they can get to that passion, hopefully, you know. But on the other hand, people that are professional musicians usually spend a good 30 years studying to get to that level. And they are an important part of society. You know, take all of that away and we'd have a pretty drab existence. So it's the awareness that, you know, by creating Claflin Hill, I wanted people to understand that, you know, this is what we do for a living. You know, it's not... You know, I don't get these calls anymore, but sometimes people would call and they'd like to hire, you know, some musicians, but they don't want
to
pay that much money. And they're like, you know, well, I mean, do you ever have some people that maybe just want to rehearse, you know, sort of, you know, try out?
Yes, they do that every day on their own.
So they rehearse and I pay them for rehearsal. You know, they get paid when they rehearse. That's part of the job,
too. Do you ever go to work and not expect to be paid?
No, I know. You know, I mean... It's like, do you go to the store and see if you can get away without paying for the food? I mean, you know, somebody had to create this. Somebody needs to pay their electric bill.
One of the things Claflin Hill, one of the urban legends, let's say that Claflin Hill debunked, is you have to be very wealthy to enjoy high-level classical music. You know, you go into Boston, it's a $300-$400 night before you blink.
Yeah.
Or probably like have dinner, $500 a night. Not everybody, you know, we're a blue collar town. Not everybody can just say, you know, hey Susan, not doing anything tonight. Let's go drop $400 or $500 and go to a concert. Claflin Hill, I can drive from my house in 2 minutes or 10 minutes anywhere from Milford. What are the most expensive seats in the house? $35, $40
$40.
Let's see, last time I looked, I don't pay for parking at the Middle School East. I can go to my favorite restaurant, home, or anywhere in Milford. Mm-hmm. So the idea that I have to put out, I have to budget to go to a concert, was destroyed by Claflin Hill. You can go to the highest level of music at a reasonable price. Question comes out, the youth orchestra, is that affordable to... blue-collar families?
It is, actually. I mean, all of our pricing for things, you know, tickets, you know, and like, actually, everything you just said, you know, it goes back to my own teacher who played Broadway all his life, you know, and I think I've told you before how, you know, he used to bemoan the fact that, you know, in the 50s and 60s when he played all those great shows, and there were maybe 30 new shows opening every year on Broadway. Now you get 5 shows and you think you're doing a great season, you know. But, you know, he said Broadway was the working class's entertainment venue, you know. I mean, tickets were priced to a level where, you know, somebody, a working class family, could go to a matinee on a Sunday, go out for dinner or a burger or something with their 2 kids, and they didn't have to work for 3 months to pay that off. Now it's like, you know, only the wealthy really can afford those tickets.
Again,
you know?
You're back to the $500 night.
Right, exactly. I mean, same thing. I mean, Susan and I went to see once 2 years ago. You know, the show once, it was the movie and then it became a show. A great show, I liked it. We loved the music in it, you know? And we went to I think it was at the Boston Opera House. You know, and I thought, well, this will be a nice Christmas present. So I called up to order tickets and probably went online. And then there's the ticket insurance. And at the price you're paying for those tickets, I thought, well, maybe I should take out the insurance policy. I mean, you need an insurance policy on your tickets at a show in Boston, you know?
It's a capital purchase.
You know, right. I mean, it's like, what, is that in case the
should we redo the kitchen,
show,
Susan, or go out to the symphony?
Falls apart in the middle or something? I mean, you know, so I mean, I think the tickets at the end, the whole two ticket package, you know, probably ran to about $450. That was just for two tickets. Then you go into town, find a place to park, go to eat somewhere, you know.
And I mean, $500-$600 before you blink.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I don't think you can go to any decent restaurant on a show night in Boston and get away without a $200 bill for two people, you know, unless you're eating at Arby's, you know. So, you know, it's ridiculous. And, you know, again, you know, talking to our accounting firm, and she had some questions about the ticket revenue because she was trying to make sense of, you know, the amount of tickets in the accounting that were sold and how much money came in. And said, well, you know, there was, you know, certain discounts on this or that. And, you know, the student rush tickets on the night of, so, and youth orchestra member kids, they all get a free ticket. So yeah, it counts as a student ticket came in the door, but that one was actually free. And I was saying to her, you know, it might be me. I mean, I'm a little silly because I'm like, want to give everybody a deal. I said, but you know, we're not actually paying the organization on the back of ticket sales anyway. So why gouge people? I'd rather have a full house, you know, at a cheaper ticket price, and everybody went home happy, and they didn't get gouged, and they enjoyed a great concert. And the same thing with the youth orchestra. I mean, kids that are members of the Boston Youth Symphony Orchestra or the New England Conservatory Prep Orchestra, or, you know, they're paying upwards of $2,000 a year in tuition.
That's got to be tough for, you know, a working person.
I know, get your credit card out.
You know, you sit there and say,
my dad paid through the nose, you know, it hit at whatever level when I was a kid. I mean, he always, whatever, okay, I guess
well,
you want youth orchestra.
Make it work, but.
Right. But I mean,
holy moly.
I think that's a little ridiculous. I mean, right now, our highest tuition fee for the symphony orchestra, and if the kid also plays in the wind ensemble, is like $600 for the whole year.
So
I mean, it's going to go up at some point, but it's not going to be $2,000.
$50 a month, we can all afford.
Yeah, I mean, think about it. I mean, that amounts to, you know, you're paying an organization like basically about $18 per rehearsal day.
Right.
To entertain your kid for $6 an hour, right?
To teach my kid
a
skill set, I'm paying $3 an hour.
Yeah. I mean,
but you know, it's more not justifying the hourly rate, but $50 a month ish, $40 a month ish. Okay.
Right.
Most of us can afford that. That's $10 a week. Okay. I can deal.
Mm-hmm.
Start getting to $50 a week. I mean, that kind of hurts people.
Yeah. I mean, at any rate, I'm a believer in affordable for all, just bring in bigger numbers.
Now, one of the things that I was always proud of is it's the corporations around Milford, it's the small business owners that really keep Claflin Hill alive.
Yeah, well, it's like 50-50. I mean, you know, the income from private donations equals what the corporations at this point. You know, when we started out, it was almost like 70-30, you know, it was on the backs of companies. Now, private citizens.
But donations in a whole
got
to be 70% of the budget.
At least, yeah.
You know, when you think of filling the town hall, we're all proud, we're all excited, but that's 20-30% of the revenue.
Right. No, that's true. And we've been fortunate in this town that, I was fortunate that I moved to this town, and that, you know, when lightning struck and said, oh, I think maybe I'll try and start a symphony orchestra, you know, that this is where I was. I mean, I don't think it could have happened somewhere else, you know. You know, there's many wonderful towns.
You know, you think about, you have banking night,
mm-hmm.
and you have some strong supporters there.
And we have healthcare night, and you know, just, you know, we've got a strong base of corporate and business residents in the greater Milford community, and even the smaller companies. You know, maybe they can't afford to be a major sponsor of Symphony, you know, and get their name announced for the, but they're buying program book ads, you know? I mean, you know, whether it's
200-300 bucks multiplied by a number of people.
Spallones, you know, on Main Street, or, you know,
but some of the names you look at,
AutoGo, the guy you do business with,
it's the same names every year. You know, the bank sponsoring. You look at Waters. You can always count on seeing Waters in
Waters, Milford Federal, you know, Medway Oil and Propane. Now the Milford Water Company is now a sponsor.
But that makes you feel good because, yeah, I've been going to Milford Fed for 100 years. It's nice that my little bank shows up helping the community.
Yeah.
That's a nice statement.
Well, I think, you know, and I look at some, and I won't mention names, but there's, you know, there are banks, and maybe they're not actually based in Milford, you know, but they have a branch here. And you just wonder sometimes, I mean, because it's not just Claflin Hill, perhaps some of these, I don't see their name anywhere.
No, but these companies that kick in, you see them helping the kids in sports. You see them helping the kids in the arts. You see them helping, you know, different programs. You really sit there and say they're invested in Milford.
Mm-hmm.
They're part of the Milford family.
Yeah. Well, I think that's an aspect that goes for everybody. I mean, I think if you live in a town, then you have to be invested in it. You know, I mean, I find it strange sometimes when you talk to people, you know, that maybe you know that live in this town and they're unaware of things.
Yeah.
I mean, they're unaware there's a symphony, or they're unaware that there's, you know, family night, the bandstand on Tuesday nights all through the summer, or, you know, name a bunch of other things. It's like they get in their car, they've been living in the town of Milford for how many years, you know, their kids are going to schools. I mean, they probably don't even read all the flyers that come home with their kid in the school bag. They're kind of oblivious, and they go in their car and they go, you know, trudge up the highway like you have to do every day. You know, they don't listen to,
you know,
the local radio station or read the paper.
I laugh because I looked at my daughter. I said, "You're finally a true Milfordian." She goes, "What do you mean?" I said, "You're third generation Milford. Now my grandson is fourth generation Milford, and you live within 2 miles of your mother."
Well, there you
that
go.
That makes you a
exactly. Yep. I mean, you know, I think, you know, it's one of the things. I mean, I grew up in a town. It started out being like Milford, but then it blew itself into, you know, gigantic sprawl and bedroom mall community, and, you know, I never felt invested, and I grew up there. I spent 30 years there before I got in the car and drove up here to get married, you know? I mean, with Milford, I feel like I've lived here all my life, and you know, I feel invested in it, that it's important to know everything that's going on,
I mean,
and to do what you can do.
When we moved to Washington, we lived in Northern Virginia, in a little townhouse cul-de-sac. There were 20 houses. We went away for 4 years to Paris. We came back. There were two people still there.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, now in 4 years, there was two people plus us. There were three out of the 20.
Mm-hmm.
And you sat there and said, "I don't have any roots. I don't feel part of this community." Whereas Milford, the gravitational pull brought us back.
Yeah.
And it keeps us here now.
Well,
with the family.
I not having been born here but transplanted, I can see how, you know, all these people that I do know whose kids live 2 miles from the, and now their grandkids, you know, I mean, I could repeat that same formula, you know, at least 10 times over,
right,
without thinking too hard. But, you know, that's part of being, and Claflin Hill is an orchestra. Should be something like that. You know, it's not just an orchestra. It's more, it's got to be more than an orchestra.
But you
orchestra.
See the same
gotta,
familiar faces.
Well,
this
it's
angle.
The same, yeah.
There better be a turban over here, or I know something's missing. There better be, you know.
The musicians invested in this orchestra. I mean, they came here, maybe originally some of them, you know, started, you know, they got a call, you know, "Can you play on this game?" "Oh, okay, I can do that. I have those dates free. And, you know, how much does it pay? And how do I get there?" You know, and then they get here and, you know, in our hall, in a concert, the energy you feel. I mean, you know, I'll tell you, I hear this over and over from musicians. I mean, I hear from the audience how much they love the orchestra. I hear from the musicians, you know, how unique it is to play in this orchestra, in our hall, with this audience, you know, that, you know, I mean, I'll tell you a short story. Last year, one of our concerts, we did like the romance night, you know, we did Serge Prokofiev's Romeo and Juliet from the ballet, and then we did Howard Hanson's Romantic Symphony. By the way, did you like that? Because you were a little leery of it.
I always laugh, the audience got to their feet at the end. You know,
of it.
The Night of the Fifths.
Mm-hmm.
Mm, Shostakovich. Mm. Now I find I'm listening.
Yeah.
You know, in the office, I've got it.
You know, we get done with the Howard Hanson Symphony. Everybody was like, I mean, they were roaring at the end of that. Well, that one's in the last. It's like, what do you do next? Well, I guess we'll end with Tchaikovsky's Romeo and Juliet tonight. Now, there's this section in that overture where, you know, it's like a battle scene, you know, and the brass are
gone.
Dun, 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 dun. You know, it's like a sword fight, and the strings are wailing away. And then it mounts up to this, you know, run that goes way up. And one of our cellists, Cameron Sausen, she lives like at Four Point in Boston. And she wrote me an email the next week and said, you know, it was just amazing. You know, at that real climax point of the Tchaikovsky, you know, and we were just all so in sync and really scrubbing away and all these notes and the brass were hitting and the winds and the percussion. And then we climbed to the top of that run, and it was exhilarating, and she said she looked out for a second, took her eyes off, you know, because she's sitting on the outside. She looks toward the audience, and everybody was like,
well, we were all standing straight up.
Like that, and, yeah. And she said, and I just felt nothing could ever be this great, you know? And he's like, yeah. Now you've drunk the Kool-Aid. Now
yes.
You understand Claflin Hill, you know?
But I mean, that was it. I mean, everybody is not standing up at back straight like, oh, my God.
Breathless, holding your breath. I mean, you know, and that's what it's like to be in our audience, in our orchestra.
It was the same thing when that Night of the Planets. When you were done, it was like, okay, I felt like Achilles. Somebody pulled the plug and my adrenaline ran out. Oh, my God.
Well, another one that is one of my favorites, and we've done it twice, so I guess I have to wait a little bit before. I want to do Pines of Rome again someday because, I mean, the ending of that piece, you know, with the last movement is the depiction of a Roman centurion regiment, the ghosts forming up, coming back to life and marching down the Appian Way into the center of Rome. That's
you can feel it. You can
almost
feel it.
That's something to be playing that
now,
piece.
Now, before I get in trouble, Saturday's concert.
Yeah, we should talk about it before
say,
we close out. There's,
before
yeah, we're doing a concert.
The big names are all coming here.
Yeah, we have Beethoven. I mean, this concert, because I kind of wanted this year to include some great symphony pieces, you know, the symphony, I mean, is a form of work, of musical work, right?
Symphony number one of Claflin Hill is always, if I could call it, the most classical, most sophisticated.
Yeah.
It seems like the most challenging technical
It could be.
Piece.
I mean, it depends. Is it challenging for the audience or the orchestra? Maybe both. I mean, I don't think so much for the audience, but
no, but for the orchestra, it's not pops.
It's no.
They got to work.
Yeah, but this one is actually. This one is going to feel leisure because it's so beautiful. The pieces are so gorgeous. And technically, I mean, the only thing difficult about them is to make them as gorgeous as they should be, which I have no doubt we're going to be able to do. But the opening in the Shadow of Ludwig is, you know, Beethoven was this humongous figure in music. I mean, he came, you know, at the end of the classical period, right after Mozart and Haydn, and kind of changed everything.
Changed the world.
I mean, started out as a classical composer, and in his third symphony just suddenly blew the whole form apart.
Yep.
On how it should be written, how it should be
organized. Played.
And then from there, you know, he wrote the rest of his, you know, ending in the Ninth Symphony, which has become like a, you know, a hymn of the entire human race, okay? And everybody knows that. Well, think if you're a composer, working, struggling, trying to get your music heard, and you're just like, you know, there about 2 years after Beethoven's died, and all anybody's talking about is what Beethoven did. How would you like to be the next guy, right?
How do you follow?
Right, and so, you know, I picked two symphonies, one by Mendelssohn, great, great, wonderful composer. I mean, German. He was from a banking family, actually. You know, the Mendelssohn family were like the Rothschilds in Central Europe during the 1800s. You know, they probably thought he should.
But it doesn't feel heavy Germanic.
No, it isn't, because he kind of was a world traveler, and he went to Italy and to Scotland, and he was influenced by all sorts of things. But you know, he's got the German form, but he writes beautiful melodies. And I think he was always kind of an underrated composer. You know, he didn't get the play or the statue like Beethoven
You're
did.
Following Beethoven.
Yeah.
How do you get out of that shadow?
He died kind of young, too. I mean, so we're doing his Fifth Symphony, which he had written as sort of in tribute or in honor of, I think, the 200th anniversary of the Protestant Reformation. And then the second half after, well, we're starting with Beethoven's Egmont Overture. So that's Beethoven, you know, and that's a great overture, not a symphony, but people will recognize it. It's a fairly familiar work and written around the same time as the Fifth Symphony. So it's got that kind of monumental stature to it and visceral feeling. And then Brahms on the second half, Brahms' Fourth Symphony. Now see, Brahms wrote four symphonies. He labored for 20 years on his first one. I mean, he wrote it and then put it away and wouldn't let anybody hear it for 20 years because he was afraid it would be compared to Beethoven and that it would not be taken as kindly as Beethoven.
It wouldn't meet the measure.
And his first symphony is amazing. We did it in 2004. I still can remember that performance. I can remember it was the year the first, you know, the Red Sox won the World Series, broke the curse. It was that same season, same fall, and everybody was in a state of euphoria over the Red Sox, finally. And then we did this concert, and I remember one of our flute players, Laurie Holt, emailed me the next week and said, "We're like the Red Sox of orchestras." But so we're doing his Brahms' Fourth Symphony, which I think is his finest. It's his most noble. It's got everything in it, every emotion of the human spirit. You know, there's some melancholy.
It's the fullest
defiance.
It's the fullest of all.
Right.
Because you're experiencing all of human nature all in one shot.
And the funny thing is. You know, because I was originally going to do the Third Symphony this year, but I don't know, I got listening to the Fourth. I was actually, you know, sitting with my son Zach one day, and he just kind of loaded up Brahms 4 on his little gadget, you know, and we started, it's like, oh yeah, we have to do this one instead. This is the one.
I always find it amazing with the depth of talent. Claflin Hill can play anything. How you decide what you're going to play and how you mix. Because so many times, Paul, candidly, I feel like saying he couldn't decide, so he's doing two whole symphonies in one night.
Sometimes it's like that because, you know, it's like being in a candy store and you want all the candy. And you only have several trips to make to the candy store, so you're loading up, you know. And sometimes, you know, and another aspect is to do some of these things, but to put around it on the program other things that will be familiar to the audience or, you know, like comfort food for them. I mean, and, you know, when you're doing something like a Brahms symphony, I mean, it's not like you can do, you know, a John Williams soundtrack on that night. It just doesn't... It'd be like having a Twinkie with, you know, a filet mignon.
Twinkie on a dinner plate. Somehow they just... It's,
you know, you got to... It can be... But, you know, this season, you know, I started out and I have, you know, like a Sibelius Symphony in February, and in March we're doing Vaughan Williams C Symphony, which, you know, Vaughan Williams, hey, the guy wrote Greensleeves, you know, everybody loves that.
Everybody knows.
You're going to love it, right? And we're going to do... It's going to be a C program, so we're doing some Debussy on that one, and also James Horner's soundtrack from A Perfect Storm, you know? So it just all kind of came together, and I got done earlier than usual trying to formulate the programming and said, wow, this is a good season. I mean, I can't wait to do this season. This is going to be cool. And that's pretty much what I'm hearing from the audience, too.
We haven't had underwhelming season. You can't look back and say...
No, I guess that's true. And I mean, God save us if we ever do. Because,
no, but I mean okay, this is not like bubblegum that, okay, we're going through the motions.
Well, I mean, you know, Judge Larkin comes up to me at the end of every single concert and shakes my hand and says, you know, I know you're tired of hearing me say this, but because I just didn't know how you were going to, you know, top the last concert, but you did that again tonight.
I think the thing that hits you the most on this side of the aisle is how many people at the end just sit and say, wow. You know, that, I can't think of a finer tribute.
Yeah.
We all stand up, we all clap, but it's when you look at the people just saying, wow. You know, Planets. Oh my God.
Yeah.
You know, it was just...
Or even if it was the movie soundtrack night, or, yeah, you know, Opera to Broadway, Holiday Pops. I mean,
the concert that one of your own musicians wrote.
Oh yeah, Ulia's piece.
Amazing. I could almost feel the hills.
And, you know, I was listening to that a lot this summer again, and it was bringing tears to my eyes again. And, you know, I was just thinking, my God, what? I actually was listening to this little disc we made of just like, it was romantic adagios, you know, and we were giving it as a gift to chair donors. And so I was listening one day. I had picked out each and every track on that, and they go from concerts going back 10 years, some of them. So that gives you an idea. That orchestra sounded that good 10 years ago. Yeah. But, you know, I just was sitting there one day, several times, in awe, thinking, my God, what a great orchestra
they
are. We're
back to wow.
Yeah. I mean, I just can't believe that's not a Sony recording.
But then you've got Andrew bringing his whole Bulgarian family in one night, and there's so much that goes on that is just so Milford.
Yeah, it is. It's a family, and Milford's a family, and our orchestra is a family.
Part of the Milford family, and for that we thank you.
Well, thank you. I mean, it's your town. Well, you let me in, so thank you.
And as always, this is one of those gems that I didn't understand classical music. I still don't understand classical music. Orders of magnitude less than most. But it's a wonderful experience. You know, bringing your family to the Pops is fun. Bringing them to these other concerts and letting your children experience it is amazing. It's something that it's very rare that other towns can offer their residents. You can go there and not, as Paul mentioned, you don't have the budget to go to the Claflin Hill Symphony, but you get an experience that, candidly, I'll go to Claflin Hill before I go to BSO. It's in my town, 10 minutes, no fighting for parking, go to my favorite restaurants, see my neighbors. It's just a great experience. If you haven't had a chance to experience it, please try once at least, because 10 years ago, no, maybe more now, 14 years ago, I got invited to one, and I've been in same seat all the time. So as always, may God bless. May tomorrow be a better night than tonight. Thank you, and thank you.
Thank you, Al.
Since I've been